if it's by force, then it's by Satan's power, because a father does not work that way. A father invites, although he is all-powerful, he does not force. Although he is all-knowing, he does not expect, but rather he forgives. He has bestowed upon us grace and mercy. He has given us time and room to grow. He is the one that comes in and cleans out our gardens, and he's also the finisher of our faith. He began something in us. He's going to complete it in us. We won't do it. He will. Never once did it say we were the finishers of our own faith. That statement within itself should take the fuel out of all these self-endeavors to cause everybody else to see what we see. You need not force. We demonstrate. And as we learn, we demonstrate more effectively. All for the sake of the kingdom. But see, when Jesus died, he was raised from the dead. He died to your sins so that you could still live, but yet get rid of all those stains and spots and blemishes so you could put everything in the grave and turn away from the grave, from those dead things, unto life. Jesus is the first begotten of the dead, and we followed after that. No one, not one of us can ever boast that by our own power we saved ourselves, by our own power we were enlightened, that by our own searches and intellect we have found the truth of this and that. It was Christ who had us be born again. To be born again is to be alive again. And to be born again means you are not what you formerly were, because what you formerly were is dead. All of what people said against you, whether you caused it upon yourself or not, all of the condemnation, everything is dead. That applied to the old creature, they cannot speak to what has been born again. Do you know why? Because Jesus said they would not see it. It would not be revealed. It would be revealed when he is revealed. And because they cannot see it, guess what? They cannot taint it. They cannot make a comment about it. They can't do anything with it because it's clean. It is unseen. It is clean. And you will be revealed when Jesus is revealed. So they can't touch what has been born again. They cannot corrupt it. They can't see it. And do you know what that means? No one can mess you up again. If any remnants of the one that is dead start speaking to you, don't entertain it, but simply say, that's what my Lord died for. Do you know Rome was called a dream? And the people made it a reality. But at the very top, those people stayed at the top. And the people below, due to a lack of education, thought everything they said and did was real. So it was important to them to arrange the classes to keep respect so that the people could recognize power. Because men have a natural habit of honoring power and wealth. Whatever they define wealth to be, men have a habit of honoring that. Even right now today, they set an agenda at the top and the people believe in it. We live our lives by a dream. It's not reality. It's a dream. We've made it a reality. We have. We have an entire society based upon someone's dream. We make it real. They sustain that dream. They stay the leaders. We stay the elements that make the dream happen. We make it real to one another. And it was also very important that they have outlets for emotions as they built up, because they found out no one would sustain the dream unless they had an emotional outlet, which is war, which is constant competition. Even the Grecians wrote about the importance of constant competition. The Grecians were known as the philosophers. Rome used to often utilize Greek philosophy to govern the people. That's where advisors came from. We do the same thing today. What we have today is a recreation of a Roman-Grecian society. From the Senate, Democrat, Republican, all of it is ancient because it worked. And if you put all that together, you have a multicultural system just like Babylon. Babylon was multicultural. Remember King Darius versus King Nebuchadnezzar? So then loyalty to the kingdom actually made a person a citizen of Babylon, not necessarily a person's race. We do the same thing here. It's an indoctrination. Jesus gave us how to combat it. It's called the gospel. It's to let a person know, hey, there's another kingdom. Absent this stuff that you see for yourselves. These kingdoms that we live in this world, in order to go up, somebody has to go down. Not with our Father's kingdom. Nobody has to go down in order for others to go up. Due to the Father's love, he desires us to know him. He is educating us and teaching us so that he can give us everything. That's why you're a joint heir with Christ. Don't you forget about that. You're just not some subject. You're not a normal brother or a sister. You're a joint heir with Christ. Now, to be a joint heir, based upon God's principles, you cannot cause any blessing from the Father to become a weapon against anybody or yourself. So you have to be trained before you are blessed. You have to be raised up, reared up, bought up responsibly. Because the Lord does not give just what we think he will give, but he's able to do above and beyond what we're able to ask or think. You know what that means? If he's able to do above what we're able to ask or think, then it has not entered into us what he truly has for us any given day of the week. That means you have no idea what the Father has for me, and I have no idea what the Father has for you. Why? Because it's above what we're able to ask or think. And if it's above that, our brains, they don't have the ability to comprehend what the Lord has for us. Because if you live your life by government, by what they're saying, by their ideologies and hopes and dreams, and you pin your soul to it, you're going to be in some very strong bondage. You will adopt the division that they exercise. You will become their weapon. Didn't matter if you're against Democrats. Didn't matter if you're against Republicans. It does not matter. You become a weapon against someone. And you're allowing it. When you're seeing outcomes in politics, one of the first things people do, one of the only things they can do, is take a position that's been designed for you to take. They designed the position. So when you take one of their positions, you'll say, well, it's their fault, and it's their fault. I don't do that. I don't allow anything of this world to use me as a weapon against you. It's not going to happen. No, I've submitted myself to be a vessel of the Lord to be used for you. I refuse to be used as a tool of division or any other thing that God does not sanction out of his goodness and out of his love. See, it's written in the Bible that God is love. You know what that means? God doesn't do what most people think he does. A lot of people say, well, this is the way God wants it. God wants us to divide. No, he does not. He never said such a thing. That comes from those folks that are written of in the book of Jude, and they will have their day. But even I hope for them that they would even see the truth quickly, because they too can be saved. A spirit in them cannot be saved. A spirit that influences them cannot be saved. But the person can. Jesus said, I and the Father are one. The disciples said, show us the Father. Jesus said, you've been with me all this time. What do you mean, show you the Father? If you have seen me, Jesus said, you have seen the Father. If you have heard me, you have heard the Father. Meaning, what Jesus spoke is what God has spoken. So when you hear the words of Jesus, you have heard the Father. Because Jesus is the Word of God, and it was made flesh. So everything Jesus spoke, he did not do so as an individual. He spoke as the Father. So when the Father said, no, suffer these little ones to come, that was the Father speaking. When the Father did not condemn that woman at the well, when Jesus did not condemn her because she was a Samaritan, and that was forbidden for one of those women to come up and even be near a rabbi, that was the Father. Did you notice how Jesus never shoved anybody away? That's our Father. He conveyed our Father to us directly. And most people miss that. Because they'll start reading about the Father in one way, they'll disassociate Jesus from the Father, saying Jesus is kind and he's nice and he's so patient with us. Jesus is the spoken word of the living God. So what you heard Jesus say, that was your Father's embrace. What you saw Jesus do, that's what your Father did. And all those things you did not see Jesus do, like push people away, like condemn people, that's your Father's heart in that great act on the cross. That's his willingness for your sakes. That's his direct love for your sakes. Knowing our sin, knowing our level of filthiness, knowing our thoughts and our hearts and our fickle minds, he still died for us, seeing us from start to finish. God has already seen you at the day of your birth and at the day of your death and even before that, and he knew everything you were going to do and what you were not going to do, and he still sent his Son for you. And the Father did that on an individual basis. Our Father is not one-dimensional per se like we are. The Father's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. He exists at the first day of creation. He exists in the middle of creation. He's there at the end of it all. And he saw everything we would ever do and everything we are capable of doing. And he still was willing to die for us. So you tell me what anybody can do that can be so bad that the Father will not embrace them if they should ever turn back to him. In fact, he wrote that, if they should turn back to me, he kept telling us. That's some more ammunition against anger. And again, anger will always have a target. Forbid anger from utilizing you to target another human being. God has this. But the question is, will we accept our Father's love, or will we go rogue and act on our own? We know the consequences to other people's lives when we act on our own. And he still loves us. He knows exactly what we have done. He knows exactly what we're capable of doing. There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. He is not the individual portrayed by those who seek revenge, by those who have attitudes, by those who hold anything against anybody else. He is not that way. He clearly demonstrated who he is and who he will be so that we can know him. He does not change. Thank you, Lord, for that. He hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. Do you understand what that means? See, an angel is a servant, right? A priest is a servant. So if he just said he has made us priests unto God our Father, that would be similar to the angels, to serve the needs or the will of our Father. But that's not all he wrote. He said he has made us kings and priests unto God our Father. Why would he say this? Because a king declares things. Now notice he did not say he made us kings and priests unto people. That's not what he said. He said he made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. He didn't say unto people, unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. So John puts all power in this writing back to the Father before he starts speaking. But I want to tell you that you are secure. See, there's a lie going around, a lie that often has to be fought. It is the worst lie anybody could ever tell. And do you know what it is? It is that self-condemnation lie that somehow, see, somebody right now is sitting in sadness thinking that they have truly separated themselves from the living God. And their heart is broken by it because they look back on things they have done. Maybe they did it 5 minutes ago and they really do believe it separated them from the Father. Let me tell you something. If you so much as feel sorry about what you did, you are not separated from the Father. In fact, if you believe in Christ, and because he's the author and finisher of your faith, that would be an impossible act. If you really believe in him, don't get this confused with a falling away, because a falling away, that word, that phrase, is actually kin to revealing. So people will be shown, they will become what they really are. That means some never stood on the side of Christ in the first place, and they're going to be shown to be what they really are, and some have. Another name for that revealing is the harvest, when everything is shown for what it is. Jesus walked in our shoes. Jesus did not walk as a rich person. Jesus did not walk as an accepted person. Jesus walked in the hard shoes. He was a carpenter. Jesus came from a place where it was stated, no good can any good thing come out of Nazareth. That's why the Bible says we don't have an high priest who does not understand our infirmities. He understands what we're dealing with. He walked in our steps. He's the only one qualified by whom we may be forgiven of all sin. He's the only one qualified. He was born in the flesh, dealing with the flesh. The Bible says he was tempted in all points as we are tempted, but without sin. That means he knows where you're coming from. So when the Lord is, he has made you kings and priests. That means you're going to have to live the life of those you'll be in charge over, or you will have charge over. You're going to have to be in the shoes of those you're going to be appointed over. The Lord doesn't do it like man does. His ways are not our ways. The Lord does all things thoroughly and in truth. You're going to have to walk the walk of those that you will be over. You're going to have to be subject to the same things they are. You're going to know them inside and out. And the Lord has set your life up in such a way that that's happening. Because look at some of you right now. You don't even realize what capacity you have already fulfilled. Many of you would say, I've fulfilled no capacity. Yes, you have. It may not be with everybody, but yes, you have. See, you have lived a very peculiar life. Your life is not like everybody else's, and you know it. Your trials and your tribulations, they are supernatural. You did things in your life, and you have no idea why you did them. You messed up your own outcome. The point was is to have you in a position supernaturally so that you could walk the walk and talk the talk of those and really comprehend and understand those that the Lord would appoint you over. Just like he gives his angels charge over us, so will he give you charge over something else. We don't have an idea of what's in store for us, but the Lord is raising you in all sobriety. It's not some game, and it's not something we test either. He's raising us in truth because he does all things in truth. He also does it thoroughly. That means from start to finish. He does not do anything halfway. He does not have the ways of us, of man, but his ways are perfect and well beyond our ways. And he is the one that has made you kings and priests. And if you're going to be a priest unto God, if you're going to be a servant of the living God, you're going to know the ways to truthfully serve him, and you're going to be given the tool set to do it with. You're going to know what to do. You're going to know what to engage. Because in my small understanding, even as servants now have been fighting darkness for your sakes, people are praying, angels are fighting and fending off the Satans from your life. When you're sleeping nice and cozy in your bed, there's a war going on around you, and they don't give up. But they had to be trained. They had to be bought up to do that. We don't know the process. You're being bought up too for a work, to have kingship, and to be a servant in ways we probably cannot even imagine. We don't have the capability to see those things on the other side, which causes us to really live here. Because if we knew what was coming in its fullness, we would not live here truthfully. We wouldn't exist in truth. See, when you're in an issue, you really think you're in an issue. But if you knew you were going to be rescued all the time, you would not be sober in that issue. Nor would you learn compassion, nor would you learn patience, nor would you learn the qualities necessary to be like unto the Lord. You're joint heirs with Christ. You're not joint heirs after him. You're joint heirs with him. You're not joint heirs over him. You're joint heirs with him. And if you're joint heirs with him, you're going to end up with the same qualities and traits that Jesus had. He is the first of many brethren. So the Lord is not joking in how he's raising you. And this is that season that we can afford to continue as we were, in a type of blindness and in a stupor, as the Bible says. Because in these days, men will go into a stupor. People will actually believe in their hearts that God has abandoned them, which means they'll feel alone. You can either decide to receive of the Lord, or you can continue learning that same lesson until you master it. You can stay stuck, or you can move forward. That's your choice. But the Lord wants to bring you all the way home, and he will. One way or the other, he will. But I'm telling you now, if you can just stand up to yourself and say, I'm wrong and my father's right. If you can understand that statement, you're not going to stay stuck in the same cycle. Because that's when you'll actually receive guidance. And that's when you'll truthfully follow what the Lord is guiding you to do. You won't live by imagination. And I'll say it again. We deceive ourselves because we believe a lie rather than the truth. Why do I say this? Because right now we're living in tomorrow, and tomorrow does not exist. Therefore, we are doing everything today for something that does not exist. Now, in any hospital, they will call that insanity. They will say that person is delusional because they keep living for a day that doesn't exist yet. They're sad about a day that has not come yet. They're lashing out at people today over something that has not taken place yet. That person is delusional. Many says he has made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever. Listen, behold, he cometh with clouds. I like that statement. Have you guys ever thought about that statement? He cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, they're going to see him too. And all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Wait a minute. You will fit in one of two categories. You're going to be those that wail for him out of a great misery and sorrow, or those who wail for him out of relief. You'll fit in one of two categories. Everybody will do it. Even those that pierced him. Everybody will. No one will escape this. Everybody will do it. See, when the Bible says even those that pierced him, they're going to see him. That means the dead are going to see him. Everybody's going to see him. In fact, upon his approach, here come the dead rising at the command of Michael. So everybody will see him, but everybody's going to wail differently. Because some people will wail for boding torment to come. They're going to realize at that time they have ignorantly denied everything of the Lord. That they have taken advantage of their brother and their sister. And in fact, they did what they did for themselves. And they tried to save their own lives. And they're going to realize, I just lost my eternal life because I spent all my time trying to save my life. They're going to start telling the truth. They're going to be truthful with themselves. They're not going to be crafty. Now, to those who were faithful, to those who knew he was our Savior, to those who confessed to him, the world is not going to be favorable to him, nor will the conditions those people live in. So his coming is going to be a magnificent relief. See, some people will be holding on to the last bit of faith they have left, and then kapoof. See, that's why the Lord warns us. That's why he's giving us this. Listen, in that time, people are not going to be strong in faith like so many people have conveyed. That's contrary to what the Word of God says. Now, when it says in the Bible that they loved not their lives unto death, that means they kept their faith, but they struggled. They didn't just skip through the end days. And it just so happens, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why the statement "the time is in hand" was written is because Jesus said that. Jesus said when he died, the prince of the world was coming to this earth. Jesus said that. Jesus said that when he died, the prince of this world will be cast out. Satan will come down to you in great wrath, knowing he hath but a short time. See, that is what you're dealing with. That is all this deception in the heavens, both by impressionable beings and mankind. A great deception has taken place. You're going to see a whole lot more during this study. You're going to hear an admittance of those who remove certain books out of the Bible. Do you not know they wrote letters of forgiveness? You know what that is? Who knows what a letter of forgiveness is? And who has read the four edicts that were issued and the repentance letters that were issued from taking out things that should not have been removed? Removed from where? The Bible, that's where. So you have all these people who are quote-unquote experts. Or they spiritually know this, that, and the other. They have no idea what they're talking about. I'm telling you, folks, some people are in this for the entertainment. That's why you have to read the Word of God yourself. You have to have a personal relationship with the Lord yourself. Because people are doing what they're doing for entertainment purposes. They don't care about you. They don't care about the sincerity of the Word. They're doing it for entertainment. Don't be deceived. Don't be to stop following mankind and follow your Savior. He will not mislead you. But I can assure you that if Satan can use anybody, he's going to use those closest to you or those you trust in their moment of weakness to get to you. I hope you realize that. Does that make the person bad? Often it does not, because we often have moments of weakness, and Satan will utilize you against me and me against you. So what you better do is go straight to Christ Jesus. Lord, my goodness gracious. A delusion is already here. That's why it cannot be seen. It is delusional to say a delusion is coming when people are saying there is no God already. If they're blind, how could Stevie Wonder tell me, "Mike, the clouds are so beautiful"? He can't tell me that because he cannot see them. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm trying to demonstrate something to you. A blind person cannot tell you about something they cannot see. But if they do, and you believe them, then that's the blind leading the blind, because you didn't even see that the person couldn't see. You don't think a delusion has already begun? Satan did not develop this delusion. The Father sent this delusion. And no one who chooses to stay willfully ignorant will escape it. And the tragic part is they will all be damned who did not love the truth. You have to love the truth to keep it. What you love, you're going to keep, period. And if you don't love the truth, you will not keep the truth, period. Because that delusion is sent for those who loved not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. So if it feels good to you to win an argument, you've got a problem. If it feels good to you to have the last word, you've got a problem. If it feels good to you to speak your mind, you've got an issue. You've got a problem. Because those things are not righteous. And if you like them, that means you have pleasure in them. I will never identify Jesus by sight. I will only identify Christ by the Spirit. You can be fooled if you rely on anything physical to be your guide for something spiritual. Folks, I hope you understand that. You can be deceived. You can be fooled. By the way, how many things have you seen that looked good but almost killed you? How many things felt good and wholesome that almost corrupted you totally? You cannot rely upon your physical senses discerning spiritual things. You can't do that. You can't mix the two. You'll develop a lifestyle of intermingling the two. They do not belong together. The flesh is filthy unto the Lord. But you will be extracted at the last trump, and the last trump blows at the height of trouble, not before the trouble. but at the height of the trouble. That's when the mystery of God is going to be finished. The mystery of God that was given to the prophets is going to be revealed and finished. That's when everything is finished. That's also what the Lord had chastised the priests in the book in the time of Ezekiel and those folks. He chastised them because he said, you have weakened my people, lying to them, saying that they wouldn't go through any trouble. And what you should have told them was the truth, that I said they would go into trouble. That way they would be strong enough to endure what I appointed them to endure. See, the Father has something all of us have to endure. But if we believe a lie, then we won't strengthen ourselves enough to survive or to endure what we must. The Lord wants us to endure those things he sends for us because it's part of our individual process. You can never be complete until God's process upon your life is finished. Listen, I'm he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. He has the keys of hell and death. What does that mean? Do you guys know what a key is? Let me tell you what that is. No one goes to hell until Jesus says they go to hell. And no one dies until Jesus says they die. You're not going to get out of this earthly experience until Jesus says you're getting out of this earthly experience. And no one is going to hell until Jesus condemns them. People can condemn you all day. That doesn't mean you're going to hell. When Jesus is the only one, because he's been given all authority, he will appoint those who go to hell. And the last time I checked, he gave his life for the worst of us. So good luck with your condemnation, because he's doing a work and he's preparing a place for us. And he's not going to lose any of those who truly believe in him. And if you believe in him, Jesus said, the reason you believe in him is because God has given you to him and he will not lose you. So good luck to those who condemn, because you do so at your own risk. You're condemning something Jesus will not condemn. Lord, have mercy. See, that's how you defeat anger. Anger will target somebody, and you'll begin to condemn that person. Doesn't matter what the reason is. But I'm telling you, you combat anger by saying, wait, hold on, stop. Jesus died for that person too. And you forbid anger from working in your life. That's how you overcome. You do not entertain anger. You resist it by way of truth. And what is the truth? That Jesus has the keys of hell and death for a reason. Because he is the one that died for us. He died for the sinner. He died for the lame. He died for the blind. If somebody's out there and they can't understand what you're saying, Jesus died for them. If they're out there, right, and they're ignoring every good thing and they're trying to live in the world and this and the other thing, they're severely broken. Jesus died for them. If they're stuck in iniquity, Jesus died for them. He is the one that has the clock. He is the one that says time is up or you got more time. Jesus does this. We do not. The Lord is very real and he is very dependable. Focus your mind on him and stand on his word if you believe. If you believe in Christ, then believe and keep his words. He gave us three things in Revelation to take in that word and to keep that word. Boy, that's a powerful key. And when you apply it to all of the words of Jesus, you're going to have a change. Because if you're thinking about what-if scenarios, then that means you have not taken in his word. If you become frightened because of things that have not happened yet, but it makes your future look dim, you're not keeping his word. See, those things were up to you. All these things Jesus told you to do. He said the person who's going to be blessed, those that read, those that hear, which means to take in, not just hear with your physical ears, but to actually seek to understand him, and those that keep the things which are written therein, those are the people that will be blessed.